I see there the need for all of us to go to God and ask what He'd have us do in regard to His will. And certainly, I've always felt like standing up against abortion was a noble, virtuous, close to God's heart thing to do. When I was a general contractor doing construction, I had met a gentleman who asked me to do a remodel on his house. And he owned the Yellow Cab franchise in Fort Worth, Texas. And he lived out of Lake Eagle Mountain Lake. Might still, I don't know. But he invited me to come in and give him a price on putting a swimming pool in and remodeling his house. And his association and his wife were some hallmarks of in my life with the Lord. And one evening as I was finishing up, we were completing the job, I was out at the pool, I was watching the pool run and looking over our work and making sure everything was right, fine-tuning it. And this gentleman came over to me and he said that he wanted to know if I'd be interested in doing a fairly large job that had to do with six different buildings. And of course, being a hungry, hands-on-it kind of guy, eager to grow in my construction business, I said, of course, yeah, I'd be more than interested. And he said, well, to make a long story short, it was abortion clinics, remodels, and he owned them, as well as the Yellow Cab franchise. But I had no hesitation once I found out what it was in saying, I sincerely hope that our relationships that we were developing on a spiritual level as well as on a business level is not hampered by my decision that my conscience would never let me. He said, and it really made him mad. It made him angry. And he said, well, it does affect us. I said, well, in my heart, it was like, well, who should we obey, you know, God or man? So it's always been a issue that I have felt is one that we should always resist and stand up against. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this day. I thank you for this group of people, mostly familiar faces. I thank you for them. I bless them. I thank you for the opportunity that they have given me as well as you to speak into their lives. I ask that I be a good steward and that you use my tongue and my heart and my mind, direct it. Let my voice be seasoned with salt. Let my heart reflect your heart. Forgive me for the dust and the flesh that I am, Lord. And bring glory to your name and promote your kingdom. Bring it forth, Father, in the hearts and the lives of all that hear and adhere to your word. Let your anointings be upon us. Let us be open to hear your word and no other. In Jesus' name, in Yeshua HaMashiach's name, we pray. Amen. Well, as you note, I have brought out, dusted off an old drawing and brought a new one that you had seen last week. I hadn't erased it yet. And mainly I brought them to just keep our focus on what it is that I'm speaking of. And you might say, well, what are you speaking of? Well, generally speaking, I'm speaking of faith and hope and love and how these relate to us as Christians, expounded upon in Romans and Galatians primarily. And it seems to me that I just can't get very far away from Romans and Galatians, that there's just so much depth there and so much misunderstanding and so much spinning sophistries of the church out of those scriptures, that it is where my heart is most attacked by the enemy. And so I spend a lot of time continuing in the study of those scriptures. So what am I speaking about? I guess back in the background, I'm speaking about what Paul spoke of in regard to love and joy and peace and faith and righteousness and justification, those issues that are brought out in Romans, Galatians, and also, of course, in 1 Corinthians. So that's in the background. And then we have how that impacts us, spirit, soul, and body. And the drawing there that you have, that I gave you, that illustration, has to do with the spirit, soul, and body, understanding that triad being of each one of us, and just an illustration as to how regeneration, justification, sanctification, faith, koinonia, communion with God, and the wrestling match and the war with the spirit and the flesh, those are all brought out in that illustration. So in this lesson today, we're expounding upon some of those lessons from weeks past, which had to do some with having redefined definitions of words, such as grace, as opposed to that the religious community has represented to us, in that grace is the undeserved unmerited favor of God with impunity. And that when you look grace up, you find that it actually, in the Greek, or any other way you want to look at it, that as far as linguistics or languages, that grace is the divine influence upon the heart. It is the divine influence upon the heart. So that, again, is a part of the subject of today. We have to keep in mind when we say grace that we're not talking about the undeserved, unmerited favor of God. We're not talking about that. We're not talking about that because it's been twisted as into encompassing all of what the meaning of the atonement of Christ is about, which is a lie. It's a religious lie. So when we say grace, we know that we mean something that goes beyond the undeserved, unmerited favor of God, which there is an undeserved, unmerited favor of God, but it is not grace. It is not defined in the word grace. But it is a gift of God, and we'll discuss it a little further. In addition to that, we'll have in here a little bit of understanding of the two meanings of faith. That it has been perceived as being another stalwart doctrine of the religious community, and that being that faith is synonymous with believing. But we have shown that actually faith with believing is inferior to the faith of knowing. And we've talked about that. And so when we talk about faith, generally speaking, when I speak of faith, I'm speaking of something that goes beyond believing. Believing is subject to change based on new information. Knowing will never change. So there is that preliminary justifying type of faith, which is believing in God. And then there is that other, more virtuous, deeper meaning that is derived from the understanding of faith being knowing. So then again, when I speak of faith, you have to say, well, what does he mean? You know, I've spoken a lot of faith. And mostly this message is about faith. What is faith? How does it work? But involved in speaking of faith, the faith that has enough virtue unto salvation, which believing in God does not. Believing in God doesn't have enough virtue unto salvation, for even the devil believes. But there is something, there is a faith that does lead unto salvation. But when you speak about faith and hope and love, and when you speak about this word grace, you can't help but speak about the law and religion. And there's nothing wrong with religion. It's defined as true Christian religion. But that we will also discuss. And when we speak of the law, which is where I start, and when we speak of religion, we speak of those two elements that are in the world today that can only lead us here to the abyss. Religion can't. It's limited in bringing heaven to earth. So we're going to speak to the limitations of law, and as we speak about the abilities and the possibilities of true faith, and we speak about the limitations of religion, both orthodox and generally accepted true religious understandings propagated by the church. So just with that preliminary kind of review, you know, I could get into review and then I never go into the lesson. That is why I presented to you today these two particular drawings. And I'll refer to them as I minister today this message. I hope that I was told that at the men's Bible study that you went over this drawing to some degree again. That did my heart good because, you know, I didn't do a lot of teaching from that drawing, not near like I have from that drawing, but there is a lot there. And if you have that drawing, you might want to keep it for future reference. The beginning of this lesson is the law. This is a very quiet group, very attentive. I like this. The law, which I put / commandments. Yes, ma'am. Well, you certainly may. Do we have a copy left here? Is this? Of the lesson. Yeah, we do. Great. You want one? You want four?
Yes.
Okay. Great. This is for the nosebleed section back there. You know, the problem with being on the last row is usually just the step from being out the door. Hey, yeah, you got to have a printed copy of the lesson because it's hard enough to follow me when you have a copy of my lesson. If you don't have it, you have no idea what I'm talking about. Now, it really isn't intended to be esoteric, you know, something that is so difficult to understand that only a few understand it. But then again, the things of God are simple, but yet complex. They can be understood by anybody, but yet they're layered and layered and layered and layered. And to be quite honest, I'm digging to the bone. I want to get to the bone. I mean, I want to eat all the meat. And that's not to mean that the very simple things I should ignore. But these things will require you to have your concentration, your spiritual ears on. They're not easily comprehended. Which doesn't speak to anything except God and His unfathomable reaches. And in here I wrote that I would be able to grasp the truths that I am espousing. You know, they seem to me to be like Solomon warned, don't try to understand things that are too difficult for you. They seem to be borderline there to me. But yet I feel, I sense, and I have sensed for weeks and weeks the calling of the Lord. Come on, come on. Are you sure, Lord? That looks awful deep for this boy. I mean, we're talking to a guy that doesn't have a high school education here. So how, oh Lord. Okay, I know. You take the base things of the world and confound the wise. We don't have to have this high acumen and intellectual prowess to be used of God or to understand the things of God. Praise the Lord. And you know, I was encouraging my granddaughter to learn words, you know, because it's words that help express God to you and you to others. So if you find some words in here that I could not spell unless I had a dictionary, because I don't believe that you shouldn't use a word that you can't spell. I believe that you should use any word that better expresses what it is that you have to say about God. And I also use the same thinking that in that there is any plagiarism in this, it is not meant to be anything but the ability to express what I already know of God to you, if that makes any sense to you. The law / commandments and true religion can only bring us to the Jordan River. Now I'm throwing in a little bit of Torah today, because today is the lesson on Jethro, the father-in-law of Moses. So I just touched on it here, so that even though that statement there is not in this lesson of going to the Jordan, that's where they're heading. They're just beginning the journey. They've just come out of Egypt when Jethro comes to meet Moses, but I'm going to throw a little Torah at you here in this first paragraph. The law, commandments, and true religion can only bring us to the Jordan River that runs to the lowest place upon the earth, the Dead Sea, the abyss of carnality, and cannot take us across. That is, bring the heaven to earth. Matthew 6:10. Only by beholding the ark can we pass over and overcome the carnal mind and inherit the promise and promised land. Here I've mixed metaphor, or I've mixed the Torah, plain text, with the sod, or the spiritual meaning, in that I have compared the Jordan River to the carnality of the mind. And that carnality of the mind, I have said, dumps into the Dead Sea that nothing lives in. Are you with me? Spiritually speaking, the law and religion, Moses, whoever, can only bring us so far. It can't take us across this abyss. It can't take us across carnality. It can't take us past the Jordan River. It can only take us to it. Are you with me here? So I am saying that the Jordan River that lies within all of us is the carnality, and more specifically, the carnality of the mind. For truly is the place of the battleground, is it the mind? Where Paul refers to in Corinthians of pulling down every thought and bring it into the captivity. This is the Jordan River. And that where this carnal river leads us is into the abyss. And the only way that we can cross over, get over it, get it, overcome it, is by beholding the ark, beholding Christ. Isn't that what we studied last week, 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verses, I believe, 17 and 18? Okay. That's just to open your spiritual eyes to what the lesson is going to talk about in regard to the law and faith. First, the Word of God. When I write first the Word of God, I mean the first thing that happens to you and I as human beings is that we are approached by the Word of God. God speaks. That's the first thing that happens. The persuasion is what God attempts in His speaking. The persuasion received is deliverance. It's the deliverance, redemption out of Egypt. That's the initial writing upon the heart. Followed then by that which comes later, the entering into the promised land, which is the inscribing upon the heart or hidden man. So there is a written, and then there is an inscribed. This truth is brought out in the two sets of tablets of Moses. The first set being both hewn and the law written by God, entirely by God, and representative of that minor faith and grace in the first purpose of the law, the first purpose of the Word of God in His persuasion or His approach to man. That is, that God may regenerate him. That is the redemptive side. That is the voice, the calling, the Word of God, the law of God that brought us out of Egypt, redemption. The second set of stone plates set God, or God required Moses to prepare the tablets representing the necessity of cooperation in the second greater and more noble faith and grace to which the law points, that is Christ's likeness, that which is the reconciliatory part of the atonement. Now, I suspect if you haven't heard me speak before, you didn't follow much of that. But what I'm saying is the law speaks on two levels, or it speaks at two different times. The first law, or Word of God, will bring you to that place where you will be persuaded in the need for redemption. The second place where the law points or brings you to is a point that you have to help him you out. It isn't just only God that is like it is in the redemptive, but now it is a cooperation with God represented in that second ewing out of those commandments that came first by breaking the commandments. Are you with me? And then there is a greater degree of faith and grace that accompanies the second point of the law. So the law, in its first regard, leads you to redemption. In the second part, it leads you to a further depth of the atonement of Christ, which has to do with reconciliation unto God. Just to underscore it once again in your mind, but to take not the redemptive and reconciliatory part of the atonement as the text for teaching, but taking you to the law and what the law is doing in regard to reconciliation and redemption. Are you with me? So I'm talking about here, I've I'm bringing a different perspective on the realities based upon the law and what the law is and what the law does, its function. And here I'm pointing out to you that it has several. Two primarily, that of redemptive, it points toward redemption, but it points toward reconciliation as well. And I'll show you how that it does that. The first is well known in that you see by the law that you are a sinner. So it's fairly easy and on a simple level that the law speaks and you respond accordingly. The second level, that where you hew out for God, that your own heart that he inscribes upon is a little more subtle understanding, but yet once seen, it's as clear as the other. The law of God first testifies to the need of a Savior on that first level. This is the redemptive part of atonement. This initial regeneration equates to a justifying faith. Here's where the church has stopped. They've put the emphasis upon justifying faith, ignoring the rest of the atonement as if it's all fulfilled in the law that has pointed toward the need for you to be redeemed because you're a sinner. That's where it stops, right there. In this initial regeneration equates to justifying faith an inferior believing in God, subject to change based upon new information. So here we find this depth is not there. We've just come out of Egypt and we really don't have a lot of depth. We're listening and we have instruction and correction accompanying us, but yet we don't have much depth. And this is believing in God. We're believing in God. If you'd ask any of them, do you believe in God? Well, of course we believe in God. But the continual implicit is attention, beholding in the mirror the face of Christ who changes us from glory to glory. The continual looking into the law. What law? The law. The commandments of God, the Word of God. That is instruction with heeding, with seeing the exceeding sinfulness of sin. We saw sin as sin, and we saw our need, but we didn't see the exceedingly sinfulness of sin. That's a need. That the law in its second position reflects that sin is not just sin, but it is exceedingly sinful. Now we're working on depth. Exceedingly sinful, this understanding brought out in Romans 7:13. The Spirit now revealing the insufficiency of our own righteousness. By looking into the law on this other second, more virtuous level, we see the insufficiency of our ability to maintain or propagate righteousness. You with me? The Spirit now revealing this insufficiency of our own righteousness, creating the void or vacuum where a knowing, remember I spoke of believing as opposed to knowing faith, where knowing faith, a perfect or mature faith, fills. This understanding is partially brought out in Romans 8:1-5, where it speaks. I will speak of a little more. This is that faith that fills, is that reconciliatory faith that equates to believing God. Do you think that's subtle? It's not subtle at all. Believing in God and believing God are polar opposites nearly. Right? Believing in God and believing God are two different things. You see, Abraham was justified because he believed God. We're speaking of believing in God as this initial grace that leads us out redemptive, but we're speaking of the need for a knowing faith that is much deeper, that goes much deeper, that leads us to believing God. See, knowing and believing God are synonymous. We're believing in that redemptive side is subject to change. Oh, you don't think you can fall? Well, I don't think there's many in this group that doesn't think they can fall. I don't think the Bible speaks of that at all. And we've gone over it, over it, over it, over it, over it, over it, over it. Hundreds and hundreds of places and times. So that this reconciliatory understanding that is brought about by the law is a deeper relationship with God than that of believing in God, and now is believing God. We are speaking here of what is law's purpose. What is law's purpose? Well, the law has been passed away. No, the law hasn't passed away. The Bible says the law will never pass away, that it's eternal. Well, the law is not good. Well, no, the Word of God says the law is good. Matter of fact, it says it's good and perfect and righteous. So the law hasn't passed away. Well, we've been delivered from the law. It's a curse. No, the Bible doesn't say that the law is a curse. It says that there is a curse that accompanies the law, which is different. So we have had these little cliches, these religious cliches that are thrown at us, which we have believed and are ingrounded in us, ingrained in us, as truths. We are speaking here of what is law's purpose, and it relates to believing in God, faith, as opposed to believing God, God's faith. In other words, one of the purposes of the law was not redemptive only, but it is also ever living to make you and I reconciled with God, to take us from believing in God to believing God. The law works both people. The more you look, the first initial look is, oh my God, I'm a sinner. But the more you look is, oh my God, I can't become righteous. Look at this. So you see, at first it's, yes, amen, we believe in God. And we're ready, you know, let's go get him, you know. And then we continue to look in the law, then we find something else. Oh my gosh. I agree with this, but I find I can't do it. So the law not only is redemptive, but it's reconciliatory. But no one, and I say no one, few have seen that we need to see past the redemptive to the reconciliatory, that religion and God's salvation plan didn't stop with redemptive only faith, but believing in him. Matter of fact, that's not even virtuous enough. But moves forward. It goes from Egypt to the promised land. It doesn't stop. It moves on. It's dynamic. The law does not affirm, but negates. Now, right there, it will destroy a religious stronghold in you if you'll think about it. The law does not affirm, it negates. See, we have thought that the law affirms. You know, we have the law written in our heart. It doesn't affirm you. The law of God does not affirm you. It negates you. Big, big difference. Not a subtle little thing. It is a big difference for us to believe and understand according to the purpose of the law. It's there to negate you, to condemn you. It's not there to affirm you. File that away. It is the way of the Lord. His command shows my condition that my will must be yielded up. My will, okay, well that's nebulous until you bring it into the illustration of what it is. The will gate. The will gate. That makes you a human being. That organ of your own choice, your own volition. You are in control of your will gate. You can open it and you can close it. It's in your control. The commandment, the law of God, the Word of God, brings us to the place of accountability for our own free choice. That God inherently created us with. It confronts it. There it is. What are you going to do about it? Well, mostly nothing, because I have another option. What is it? Well, it's religion. I don't need to do that. I can go this religious way. Well, I can tell you religion can't get you where you want to go. Oh, well, I think it can. It says it can. Okay, so law brings you to that place of confrontation with your will, and it must be yielded. It must be. It's God's way. It's God's way of unto salvation. He'll give you the gift, that of Him speaking to you. That's a gift. That's the gift. But after that, if you refuse to be persuaded in all the multitude of ways that He will try to persuade you, then your way is vain, and it will not lead you unto God's way of salvation. Before the Lord may work out His will in me. In other words, you have to open up the will gate before the Lord will work out His will in you. If you won't will to Him, then He can't will His will to you. Are you with me? All yielding the will is allowing God to expose Him to you and you to you. As long as you keep the will gate closed with whatever your stupid thinking is, or whatever my stupid thinking is, that's too hard. I don't want to do that. I'll have to give up. Whatever it is. Religion said I didn't have to. Jesus paid the price for me. This is what God requires to move forward with Him, that we yield our will. The law inscribed upon the heart provides no security or rest or excuse, but demolishes our righteousness. The law demolishes your righteousness, and that's the purpose of it. God established and gave the law to abolish your righteousness. The new law, this new law in Christ, you know, this law that the law pushes you to, this second degree, the higher degree, the more grace, the more virtue, the higher form of faith, knowing, that law that it pushes you to, that new law, now must be the law of God's faithfulness. Not faith in your faith, but faith in God's faithfulness. Or the law of faith. That's what Paul refers to, law of faith, that supersedes the law that brings the curse of sin and death. The law that brings the curse of sin and death is not abolished. It's not dead. It's very healthy. It's still working its work. But it is this new law, the law of newness of life that Paul refers to, supersedes the law, as you've heard example before in other supersedings, is that the law of lift supersedes gravity. The law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus sets me free from the gravity of the law of sin and death. See? So the new law that must rule in us is this law of faith. Faith that is yielded to the faithfulness of God. Are you with me? This righteousness is outside. Back up. This is where God now establishes him, you, me. A righteousness that stems from his righteousness, his faithfulness. That is a righteousness that originates and emanates from him. This righteousness is outside the law. It's outside commandments. It supersedes it, but it's also outside of and is intrinsic with the law, the spirit of life. This new law, the law of the newness of life that we are to be established in, is outside the law of sin and death, and it's intrinsic with the law that Paul referred to in Romans chapter 8, the law of the spirit of life in Christ Jesus. That's the law that God would that we would be established in. Well, okay, is that free from the law? No, the law is what brings us to this place and keeps us in that place. That does not affirm but negates. That's a written on your heart is not something that affirms you but negates you. So it's that we embrace his law for. Not unto condemnation, but to negate our righteousness. Well, that's been interpreted and construed and spun to mean you don't do anything. You're already there. And that's not God's salvation plan. That's a new law, the newness of life in Christ Jesus has to be initiated and lived in, and it is propagated and promoted by the law. Are you with me? These are not easy thoughts to expound. And they're not easy to capture because they are the complexities of God's salvation plan. But we are able. We are able to comprehend them by the Spirit of God. They look foolish to the world. Well, listen, what is he talking about? Blah, 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 blah. Because they're foolishness to them. And even to the carnal Christian, these things are foolish. Yeah, splitting hairs. No. They are bedrock foundational things that you've got to understand. They're not even yet the meat. You can't build off of something. You know, you have to have that foundation before you can build. And we're not even building yet. We're still laying a foundation. You know what we're doing? We're remodeling, and we're not saving the old foundation. No. That's the thing we're trying to get to get rid of. We're tearing the rest down so we can get to the foundation. And then we can get rid of that, and now let's build it on the true foundation. Not religion. Not a false sense of security, but let's build it on Christ. And the things that I'm speaking to you of are the foundational understandings of God's salvation plan. That we don't even have them right. How are we building? When we've not yet understood God's salvation plan and not correctly apprehended and appropriated it for the furtherance of his kingdom and his glory and for yielding unto him. That we've kind of just washed all that aside. Oh, give us the end. Give us the end. Glorify me, God. That's our attitude. That's presumption. That ain't faith. Presumption's foolish. It's dangerously foolish. You're not here by accident. You're not here by accident. God is interested in your every move. More than that, God is interested in your every thought and every word. It's no accident. You are here because God wants you here. And I am here because God wants me here. It, It is the end of any other attempt for justification. Can you maintain a thought while I go blah, 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 blah? I'm sorry. If I got your mind off of the thought that's being conveyed here. But what I mean by it is it's the end of any other attempt for justification is I mean that law that negates you, your righteousness, establishes that any other attempt for justification by any other means is futile. It is as if man, and that's not to mean as a general rule, that is to mean that you need to appropriate it to you specifically. It's not something to you just to look off of and say, well, that's really rather nice. No, it's something that you incorporate in your walk with God. What did he just say? I said you need to destroy any thought that you can justify yourself in any other means but by the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There's nothing concrete to hold on to. Nothing. You can't hold on to nothing. He is totally dependent upon God. That's what the law will do. It'll show you, and it won't stop. It's relentless. Finally, you see, after effort, after effort, after effort to do the law, to be righteous, it'll show you. You can't do it. You can't be that. You can't. And finally, you are suspended in midair. You are in that place of no place. Nothing to trust on but His faithfulness. Oh, okay, well, we can just be apathetic. Let's go to sleep. No, you go to sleep and you fall like a rock. Yeah, you're no longer suspended. Are you with me there? There's these illustrations that I wanted to make. I just didn't have time. The void the law was responsible for and pointed towards, that's the void. What void? What is he talking about? The void? I'm talking about when you see yourself as you should see yourself, there is a void that's created. And the law is what revealed it to you. And the void is your insufficiency. That's the law has done a great service for God when it has finally showed you that you're insufficient. Well, this sounds like a good message. This sounds like I'm taking away all your accountability. No, I'm not. Guess what? This is establishing your accountability. There's a greater and higher degree of responsibility and accountability in Christ, the law, the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus, than there was in trying to maintain the religious order of Yahwehism. You don't believe that? Just read Matthew 5. Where Christ says, well, the law says, but I say. The void the law was responsible for and pointed towards. It points toward that. I should have an arrow on this sign here. An arrow that points. Over there. Over there, stupid. Stop! Stop! A place of mortification. This place that the law brings us to is a place of mortification. The word mortification, I looked it up. It's the right word. I can't exactly remember what the meaning of mortification is, but you know. It's the right one. Look it up. It does bring you there. It's surrender and dependence, and that place is no place. And that he had nothing, no religious work to do with it. No work of his own got him there, and no work keeps him there suspended.
You see, this heavenly bridge is intangible. It materializes and dematerializes. It's spiritual. It's not concrete. So it materializes and dematerializes upon demand. You seem to be suspended as you're pulling heaven to earth. But you're not. You're standing on the bridge of the law, the spirit of life in Christ Jesus, bore by his own atonement. Are you with me? You seem to be suspended, but you're not. But you're no place. You're no place. And you didn't get there for anything that you did. No works. No works got you suspended there, and no works keeps you suspended there. Are you with me?
Christianity says that the act of mortifying the lust of the flesh by self-denial and privation, especially by bodily pain or discomfort inflicted upon yourself.
That should be two. That is a Christian definition of mortification under the heading. But the general understanding of mortification, other than for a Christian, is a humbling, humiliating.
I think one of them is self-embarrassment.
Yeah. When we're confronted with God, vis-a-vis His law, there's something wrong with us if we're anything other than broken. I mean, we're almost off page one, right? Sorry. That is to say, one who cherishes the law discovers the ever-present indictment. That's within you. That's inscribed in you. There is the indictment. The law is holy, but I am sold under sin. That's what Romans 7, that's what Paul tells us, that the law is holy and is good, but I am sold under sin. In other words, what is within me is the nature of something contrary and rebellious to God and is counter to His salvation plan. That is ever present with me, and it should be, and He says that it is holy and it is good. I have discovered I am incapable of keeping the law under the standard it demands to be righteous. That's what it was intended to do. Sin, by the law, testifies to the impossibility of ever establishing my own righteousness, negating any ground on which I stand. Any religious affirmations are destroyed by the law. Do you have no two? Oh, that's probably good. Because we can probably go a lot faster if you don't have page two. There is no page two. Is the first word on number two impossibility? Yeah.
Kind of faith.
Huh?
Kind of faith.
Kind of faith. That's page three. But you have page two? Cool. Well, the chosen one. Well, that's 2 weeks in a row. We're going to have to check this more thoroughly. But that's okay. You don't have to. Let me see if you can follow me. You can pick me back up on three. I'm going to give you a quick rundown on two because there is a statement or two in it that I really want to emphasize. So let's try it. Maybe it worked good. Man's history simply and eternally establishes man's fall. Doesn't the history of man establish the fact of his fall? I mean, that's...
We say, what is history about? And I love to get off on this, but I'm going to hold myself in check. But the history of man definitely is for the purpose of establishing he is fallen. And it does that. Otherwise, history is nothing more than a chaotic faces. History serves no purpose if it doesn't establish that man has fallen. And if you look at history under any other eyes than that, it's just chaotic faces and a multitude of personalities going a multitude of different ways without any practical purpose. It's just random acts. But if you can't see that history is nothing more than God establishing the fall of man, well, I know you can. And resulting complete helplessness and that God is God. That's what it establishes. Man's history establishes that he is fallen and he is completely helpless and God is God. We are but men. Our personal history of possibilities must be destroyed as well. It must be observed in the same way. Our personal history of possibilities must come to that end. That is our establishing our righteousness. This is the beginning of knowing the unknown God. And the basis for true koinonia. Establishing in you the truth that you're helpless and hopeless without God. Is the embarking place for the true koinonia communion with God. Your personal history usually will have to follow this establishing of your own faith, your own righteousness. It's an inexorable effect. It's something that can't be prevented. But faith begins where the faithfulness of the Almighty God meets the inspired will of man. See, faith's origin or beginning starts here when the conscience of man is being confronted by God. That the reality of God, the faithfulness of God that is brought to bear by the law is revealed by the law, where that meets the will of man and the will gate is given access to God, that is where faith originates. Faith is nothing more than God's faithfulness meeting our inspired will. That has ignored or disregarded reason and circumstance. There he is now suspended. That's something that's not concrete. That's something that's spiritual and is not of this world. That is the place that we now move from not knowing God to knowing the unknown God. Is that too? It shouldn't be, because you need to know where faith's at. That's the whole point of that dissertation, is that you understand where does faith originate? When we talk about faith, you know, and it's got all those cliches, but faith is where the faithfulness of God, the awareness of God, the attributes of God meet the willing or the inspired will of man who has ignored the concrete circumstances and reasonings of his own mind. That's where faith of God kind, the God liked faith is birthed or born or originates.
And it is the law that points to that place. Without the law, we would not arrive at that place. Without the law, we would not see the helplessness of establishing our own righteousness based upon our own works. Here, though, there is a suspension of all of that, and we take of the ethereal, that's spiritual, and apply it to us in this world that's concrete. Are you with me? We'll just say, oh me. Oh me. Where is that? Well, let me give you an example of where that's at. Here's where it's at. Oh wretched man that I am. Who can deliver me from this body of death? Where is he at? He is where that holy law took him. It could take him no other place. Oh, wretched man that I am. Oh, wretched man that I am. Who will deliver me from this body, this river, this carnality that God left in me? Who will deliver me from it? And the answer is Christ. Jesus Christ. There is the inspired will of God, of man, meeting the faithfulness of God. Faith inspired by the law's true and exacting indictment, resulting in the revelation of my insufficiency. It is the way of the Lord that my will must be always yielded up before the Lord may work out His will in me. It's Isaiah's, woe is me. It is David. It's David's confrontation by the prophet who said, you are that man. It's Daniel's knees that grew weak. It's Peter's weeping bitterly. That's the place. That's faith. That's the breaking down of anything and everything that has to do with you that's concrete and establishing God's faithfulness in you. Oh my God, what am I to do? And if the saved are verily saved, what will happen to the lost? I'm trying to establish in you the purpose of the law that you are acquiring the knowledge of, bringing into you, bringing the law, reading the law, meditating the law day and night, that God might enlarge your heart. Yeah. That's what David cried out. Oh, God, enlarge my heart that I can understand your word, that I may do your word. See, it's this, the purpose of putting in you is not to affirm you, but to negate you. You see, it's not. You see, God is the only one that could ever come up with life from death. Well, we want life from life. We just want to go from here to higher. But see, you have to go into death, into the belly of the whale before you can be resurrected in the newness of the life, the spirit of life in Christ Jesus. And that is the law who will condemn you and condemn you and condemn you day and night. That you say, oh, I thought you were supposed to affirm me. No, I'll negate you till the day you die. This is that place that faith is birthed. It originates right there where you finally have come to the place that Paul came to. Oh my God, who's going to deliver me from this body of death? Okay, so what? Does it end there? Let's go on. There is manifested His righteousness, right there, that place of no place. And there, in this state of humble elucidation, right there, that I just mentioned to you in those few men's lives, right there at that point is the place of humble elucidation. Elucidation, that goes beyond illumination. Illumination was your regeneration. We're talking about elucidation, establishing you in God, in Christ, believing God, not believing in God. You with me? Humble elucidation is further down the road. We're in illumination. We could use some elucidation here. Is God pleased that man should live? It's at that place. You wouldn't have thought that that would be the place that God is pleased that man should live. In the 51st Psalm, where David says, I have discovered, oh God, it's not about sacrifice. It's not about religious works. But it's a humble and contrite and broken heart that you choose. You wouldn't think that that's the place, the birthplace of faith. You wouldn't think that that's the place that God would have you to live. My people shall live by that. That place? That humble place? That place of humiliation? That's the place that you would have me live? Yes. Paul got there. I sought him three times. I sought him three times. The Lord said, my grace is sufficient for you. In other words, you're suspended right there where I want you, where you can't do anything in yourself. You see that? I'm trying to teach you and myself where it is that God would have us to be. And it's in this place of faith. And that's not to say, well, I can't do anything. No, now you can do all things. Where you were, you could do nothing. And you finally saw that you could do nothing. But now the journey begins. Now that salvation plan of God can kick in and get some roots and ground itself and get some traction. You're now at that place where David said, me? I'm the one? Oh my God. You see? It's that place that where Peter embarked from, that he was capable and able on the day of Pentecost to speak what he spoke. Had he not been revealed himself by the Word of God, he would have never been able to accomplish that reflection of God that he did so well on that day of Pentecost. It's brokenness and it's contriteness. That's Psalms and anyway. All these scriptures are on there. It's your first in love to the place of to love. You were in love. Oh yes, Lord, anything you say, we'll do everything you say, Lord. Yeah, that in love from redemption. The tambourine singing and dancing. We've been delivered, the horse and the rider here. You know? That's in love. That's the honeymoon. But that's just the beginning. And now where I'm speaking of this place of faith, this place where God's faithfulness meets your willing heart, this place of contriteness, that's to love. To love is you have made up your mind. You have made up your mind to love. No longer is it infatuation. No longer is it just what can you do for me? Deliver me. But now it's reconciliation of growing together. It's a to love. Are you with me there? I'm sorry to keep saying that, but it seems appropriate. I don't know why. In love is me and mine. To love is we and us. Establish it. That's what God is intending to make into us into. From we to us. I mean, from me to we to us. That's God's salvation plan. Men are forgiven by God only after He has condemned them. Life must come only after the realization of condemnation. The very breath of death must be upon the nape of your neck. It is from that place or moment we cry out for His faithfulness, His merciful blood, the blood of Christ, His righteousness. From there we have no place to stand on our own, no work, no boasting, but our righteousness is based upon hope. Our righteousness is based upon hope. Have you heard that before? Do you have any idea what that means? Our righteousness is based upon hope. In light of the things I've just said, you should see that faith apprehends. But hope holds on to that faith apprehended. So here I say, righteousness, our righteousness, is based upon hope. The hope which is holding on to that. True faith that you just apprehended in God's faithfulness. This is to say, in His promises of faithfulness with warnings. When we see sin and ourselves in the light of the law, we shall come to our end. The end of our possibilities. Where we stand is condemned. We there embark upon the journey of abiding, of yielding, and conforming to His will by His means. Communion and cooperation with the Spirit-led conscience and Spirit empowerment. What did He just say? Well, He just said that we're led on in the Spirit by the Holy Spirit vis-a-vis the conscience, and we're Spirit empowered. Living faith is the discovery of what God wants or what pleases Him and then doing it. To pursue justification is the inexorable way of all our flesh. We all are going to pursue the establishing of our own righteousness through our own works. It's just the way that we're going to go. And it's law, and it's not lost in mere regeneration. Just because you've been born again will not stop you. Matter of fact, it cannot stop you from establishing you in your own way, in your righteousness. Attempting to do that. That it must first express its possibilities. How many of us know what I'm talking about? You first have to express your possibilities, your ability to establish yourself. Your do's and don'ts list that you made when you were born again that you'll never do again and blah, blah. You're going to do that. You're going to find out. You're exploring your possibilities. And what you're going to find out is, there is no possibilities in you having a possibility. And then there is that certain confrontation with self's damned possibilities, be it selfish religious ambition or spiritual apathy. That might be what you've established your possibilities are based upon. You know what I said, don't you, Patty? I mean, you may have an idea that your religious, spiritual ambition will get me there. I'll win more souls than anybody's ever won. I'll create the largest church that's ever been built. Your possibilities might be based upon your actual spiritual false sense of ambition. Or it may be on the affirmations of a false teaching of apathy that's created apathy, which means that you have simply believed that there's nothing further that you need do, for Christ has done it all. Either one of those things that you're establishing as your possibilities will meet with the law, and it will be confronted by God's possibilities. Better pray that it will be. I pray that it will be. In this spiritual call to see the hopelessness and by His Spirit see His possibilities and to rightly value and then earnestly guard God's Word upon our heart. And that not once or twice perceived, that we are now eternally justified in that familiarity, but to remind us again and again and again and again until we are established in our insufficiency, seeing that we will never go that way again, having been chased down this mountain this many times, run down by those Amorites so many times. Now, we have finally got it. We're being established in our insufficiency, our impossibilities, and thus creating the void for the God of the God kind of faith. Page 3, you with me? We went through that page pretty fast. Are you guys with me still?
Yeah.
I have so much yet to say, and I feel like I've taken so much time in saying what I said. But if it's, again, even if I don't finish with the lesson, it's more important to say what I have to say as best as lucidly as I can, as opposed to covering so much material. But this is a mature group, and I believe you're up to it. And here we go again. This is that kind of faith that he would establish us in, with hope energized by love. 1 Corinthians 13 with Galatians 5, 5 and 6. That we might live by it. What am I speaking of? I'm speaking of Habakkuk chapter 2, 4. That we might live by it. This what? This faith, this place where we have met God. Our inspired will has met the faithfulness, the almightiness of God. This is a place that he would have us live, that we might abide in it, and that we may walk in it, in that which is germinated precisely at that point of mortification and revelation. That's that 1 John 1, 3 through 2, 6 that we have spoken of in past. This place of koinonia, of fellowship with God, that he would have us live in. That communion with each other around the communion of John, which is conveying the communion of the Lord and the Father. It is in that communion that he would have us live. In a communion that we cannot walk in darkness, for we are cleansed and held in suspension by the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus. And if we try to do works to get over or to bring heaven to earth, we fall from suspension. And if we believe that we sin not, we lose our suspension. This is 1 John 1. I'm not making this stuff up. Where he said, if you say that you walk in communion, but you continue to walk in darkness, you lie and you tell not the truth. You lose your suspension. The fellowship that we speak of is the recognition of our insufficiency and draw upon his possibilities, which in effect is the word of God in relation to the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus, which has this law that if I abide in Christ and mind the things of the Spirit, then I am imputed this righteousness that keeps me in this suspension. Is that too complicated? It may have been complicated to speak out, but it's not complicated to do. It has to do with abiding, communing, fellowshipping, and living in this faith. And that's what Christ says. That's what God meant when he said to Habakkuk, my people will live by faith. In the face of all of this adversity, my people shall live by faith. This is where he meant you to be, suspended in a trust in his faithfulness, in an understanding that you in yourself have no possibilities. But in him that you abide, you can be an overcomer. And that if you will stay in suspension or in this law, the Spirit of Christ in Jesus, if you will stay there, then you can be cleansed from all unrighteousness. As we confess, our insufficiency. Oh my God, there it is, the law. Oh my God, oh Lord. Cleanse me from all that is not of you. Help me to put off and to put on. When we're putting off and putting on, we're abiding. When we're abiding, we're suspended in that no place. That no place that has no concrete, material, earthly shape or form. We're right there. We're suspended. That's imputed righteousness. We're not perfect in sinless and infallible. We're just in the law of Christ. We're in that place of insufficiency, but we can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. You see, it's not a place of apathy. It's a place of strength and progression and abiding and drawing upon and utilizing and putting into practice and putting off and putting on and repenting and cleansing and growing and maturing and being sanctified unto God. A vessel fit for the Master's use. That's there. That's faith. Are you with me? That's where God would have us to see and to be and to live and to have our existence. For that, with that, we please God. We please God there. How could you please God and you know you're insufficient? That's what pleases Him. You see, it's the reciprocal of pride, humility, and it goes on. It doesn't stop when you die. This more excellent way is love, that's motivated by faith, that's motivated by love, carries us right on into the kingdom of God, and we continue. Continue in the eternal, ineffable, and a massive vastness of God that is so reflected in His creation. In the material, we can see the spiritual from the material. And how vast the material is, how much more vast is the spiritual. If we can comprehend this here, using physical examples to promote the kingdom of God, which is spiritual, how much more can we promote in us the spiritual things with the spiritual things in heaven? Praise God. I'm excited about God, even though I am mourning and weeping within me for the death that is in on me. I yet am excited in encouraged and full of joy in the possibilities of what I have not seen nor ear heard. Praise be unto God. He is pleased that we be here, there, that place that's no place, without possibility of our own. He is pleased that we dwell right there. It's an active place. It's not a place that you can remain in apathy for a moment that you allow apathy to start entering in your life is like putting a pin in a balloon. You're going to fall. You're not going to be suspended. Yeah, get the... Am I out of time or what time is it? I have no idea. Am I all right? The word written upon the heart is now the welcomed reminder of our independent history and its mortality. We're welcoming it, but we put it in there for the purpose of it. We want it to tell us what we are and are not. It negates. And with now the never-ceasing war with the ever-present flesh and its pronounced condemnation with imprecation, the law inscribed no of the first husband. Do you know what I'm saying there? The law of the first husband is no. And Paul refers to him in the 6th and 7th chapter of Romans. But also the communion of yes.
So we have the abiding of the law within us inscribed upon our hearts that is holy and good, but it's always my way or the highway. No. And impossible to please to the point that it requires. It's the first husband. It's the husband that we are married to that we must die to, right? And we must die so that we may have the right, the legal right, the spiritual legal right to marry another, the second husband. The husband of yes. Yes. And not only is he yes, but the word of promise, its living presence. He that is the very embodiment of the law, the second husband, he that offers the cup of the wellspring of that great atonement, that is the spirit that brings forth the water of life, that of faith and hope and love out of us eternally springs by the power of the Holy Spirit, by the communion of the Spirit of God. And the saints, it's synergism. It's exponential. The law is neither abolished nor complied with. Get it in your head. You Hebraic roots people that are trying to make sure that you do everything just exactly right to the lengths of your Z-seats and your kippahs and your new moons and festivals and, you know, on and on and on. Know this, that the law of God is not to be abolished nor complied with, but filled with meaning. The law of God is intended to be filled with meaning, with its true purpose, that is only brought about or brought to bear in the yielded heart of him that has been confronted with the Almighty God. It's filled with purpose when it confronts you and condemns you and negates you. It's not dead. It's lie. And thank God. It's the spirit of death that brings forth the life of God. It is just there that the atonement intercedes. The second husband, the husband of yes, intercedes not only for the one-time experience of redemption, but for the fullness of reconciliation, where the faithful overcomer finds in experiential knowledge the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus sets me free from this law of sin and death. Flesh, you'll have no more dominion over me. I am suspended in Christ. The atonement of Christ, bridge of God, that materializes with my mind being renewed to its possibilities, is now the law in my life. Not you, you law of flesh, you carnality. I say you have no rule over me. I reckon myself to be resurrected in the newness of life with Christ Jesus. Get thee behind me, Satan. Get thee down, my flesh. Let that I am, that God says that I am, that God who calls those things as not, as though they were, let me embrace him. Here in this suspension where I have nothing concrete, no possibilities of my own self, only in his faithfulness do I abide, humble and contrite, being delivered from this body of death. Oh, wretched man that I am. Oh, God, let our eyes be open to the wonders of your salvation. We are so ignorant, so dense, so hard, so ever learning and never coming to the knowledge of the truth, so neck stiffened that at any moment it might snap. Oh God, soften our hearts. Bring your possibilities into our lives. Let us come to the end of our own. In Jesus' name, in Yeshua's name I pray. The law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus now sets me free from the law of sin and death, and the blood of the Lamb, and by the word of my testimony, they meet. They meet. The law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus meets with the blood of the Lamb and the word of my testimony. You see, I gave you my testimony. I am nothing. I am only something in Christ. But I am something.
I am something in him. I'm nothing in me. That's the law, the spirit of life in Christ Jesus. That's appeal to the just judge. Lord, yeah, I agree with my adversary. I am what he says, but I appeal unto the higher law, the law of the spirit of life in Christ Jesus. Oh, just judge. Acquit me in him. That's where it meets. My testimony, my renewed mind, my state of faith meets the blood of the Lamb, the word of my testimony, the law of the Spirit of life, that's evidenced in that my willingness to lay down my life. Not only in this fleshly aspect, which is easy in comparison to giving up the carnality that is within and overcoming. Both are evidence in thy willingness to put to death that which is contrary unto God. To give it no life. Reckon it dead. You with me? This is active. This is wrestling. You're not in state of flux. You're not wrestling. Come on, get in here. It's not fine. But it's worthy. It's worthy. It's worthy. He calls us to sonship. What a high elevated place above everything in his creation. Above all things. To be resurrected in likeness unto him. This bears witness, bears testimony, resulting with the overcoming of the devil and the flesh. I'm telling you, there's power. There's power in our understanding. That's why he bites us tooth and nail. That's why all that surfacing of old religious thoughts and new ones, outward and inward attacks, and constantly bombarded with the things of the world. It's to grab our attention, to take it off, to create tares in our heart. Lusts and deceitfulnesses of riches and the pursuit of other things, the cares of the world. And what little teeny bit of persecution we are brought to bear upon us when we say, Jesus is Lord. Oh, shut up, you fanatic. Any of this, all of this is all geared by Satan. It's his counterattack. And it's difficult if you aren't staying your mind upon God, affirming your relationship with him, yielding unto him. It's impossible. It's only possible in him. You can't do it without him. But in him we can do it. And we'll do it. For he will have his heirs. He says he will. I won't be one. I want to be one. Go on record. Hallelujah. You have not because you ask not. Well, I have. Can say one thing. You can say a lot of bad about me, but you can't say I never asked. Because I've asked and kept on asking. I have knocked and kept on knocking. I have sought and I keep on seeking until there is no more breath in us. As Gene prayed in his prayer, we'll worship you and declare your righteousness and your goodness until we are dead. Hallelujah. This is not meant to be a sermon. But, you know, it's such an exhortation to have the understanding of the meanings and the depths of God's law, his faith, and love, and all of these parts that we are describing in connection with this salvation plan. It is hard to stay away from the excitement of the sermon. I mean, I just want to sermonize. But it's not to tickle the intellect or the flesh, but to help us to establish ourselves in the kingdom of God. To repent, turn away from whatever it is that we have or was or doing, and get in the program with God. Are you still with me?
Yeah.
This is really good. You know, I'm going to be honest, I can't preach any better. If you're waiting for me to get any better, I can't. I mean, I to me, he's hitting it right on the head. I mean, this is what we need. This is what we want. This is what God is revealing. It's as good as it gets. There ain't something better. This is it. Bite it. Hold on to it. Chew it. We are told that Abraham, the father of faith, was not justified through his works. I'm going to speak to you here a little bit of the paradox. But is this not all a paradox, really? I mean, it is. Now, I'm going to speak to you of a paradox that has always disturbed me. And so there I just keep hammering away at it, looking at it, asking God about it, reading about it, rereading, on and on. And this paradox has to do with Abraham, where the father of faith was not justified through his works, is said by Paul, but in that he believed God. The paradox we're faced with is that Abraham's works did not justify him before God, against the words of James that faith without works is dead. That's kind of a paradox, isn't it? You have the Spirit of God saying it's not by works, but you can't say that it's by faith only. So here we go. That's the scene, and I want to say, well, God, I know it's right, but I don't know what it is that you're saying. But I know it's right. So I'm not arguing with you. I just would that you would give me some understanding. The justification of Abraham, I hope I can convey it to you. The justification of Abraham was that he believed God. It is that he believed that is of vital importance and seminal. It's the beginning. Y'all still with me up there? His actions are what made God conspicuous to men, not God. See, the actions are synonymous here, what I'm talking about. They're conspicuous to man, but they're not conspicuous to God. What is conspicuous to God is that he believed. His actions are what made God conspicuous to men, not him to God. Man pleases God by believing him. Now, this is not to say that works and actions are not intrinsic and inextricable to believing. So don't go away here from saying that I said that there was something about Abraham that had to do with his believing and not acting that pleased God. Don't go away here saying that. What I'm saying to you is that what pleased God was that he believed God. Yet his actions be not conspicuous to man. By believing God, his actions were not conspicuous to man. What is being said is that surely actions speak to the presence of faith to men. But to God, it is the believing. That which preceded that which is conspicuous action. In other words, that preceded the action was the believing. Even though believing and actions are inextricable, still, it that pleased and justified him before God was his believing, not his acting. That's not too difficult to get a hold of, is it? Why am I talking about this? So I might look and sound and act smart? No, I'm trying to tie together with you those thoughts that we've already spoken of from a different practical, concrete, historical, religious, scriptural basis. Draw the things that I said and put them in context of something that happened, Abraham. So I'm trying to show you from another perspective, faith, in the best example that we have, which is Abraham, and how this faith plays out in us, in that it is that in our believing God, we are found to be vindicated, validated by God. As Abraham was. All right, let me move forward. In effect, We then before God are justified for being persuaded or believing Him, not to be confused with works we might do in order that we might be accepted or declared righteous by Him. Did you get it? In effect, we then before God are justified for being persuaded. You remember I said that there is a unmerited, undeserved favor of God, but it is not grace, because grace is a divine influence upon the heart. I'm speaking here of this persuaded, being persuaded. Speaking is the gift of God to man. It's unwarranted. We're not deserving, but yet He speaks. And it is us receiving what He says that justifies us. It is us opening the will gate and yielding and allowing the Holy Spirit access. This is what justifies us before God. And it precedes the action, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Okay. But there is also this works. There's also a works that can be confused with that we might falsely be declared, religiously declared, faithful, righteous unto God. Before man, we look to be justified by our works or actions, as they are what are or is conspicuous. Am I losing you guys? Before man, our actions may belie our true condition of heart, and we may be mistakenly declared righteous, unlike before God, who sees the motives. This is that discerning by God of the believing in Him as opposed to believing Him. That's His discerning, His motive. He can see that motive. Is He believing in me or is He believing me? See, believing in me is at a distance. It's Him, God, over there and me over here. But believing God is implicit to closeness, communion, fellowship. Now, He knows whether I'm looking at God from afar, that my lips are close but my heart is far, or He knows if I'm in communion, fellowship with Him. So He judges my actions according to what my motive was, whether I am believing Him or believe in Him. Hey, it's important that you understand that. Because this is for us. So we're not trying to judge anybody. Just us. I'm just trying to look at me. I'm not looking at you. I'm not looking at First Church. I don't care. Hey, I got to do this. I got to take care of this. I got to look at this. I got to judge me. Am I believing God or am I believing in God when I'm doing this? Well, more times than not, I'm believing in God. My actions are a lot of times just totally alien from that. It has to do with communion. Why? Because I know there's something there in me that I don't want Him to confront me with. So I'm all about believing in God and doing stuff. God judges the motive of my heart. Though I have that faith that will move mountains, that which I am enacting now from believing in Him is worthless in the sight of God for drawing upon spirituality. For drawing love, grace, faith, and hope into this heart to create a sonship, a relationship with Him, it is worthless for me to believe in Him. And these actions that I am now performing, whatever they might be, however noble they might seem, and how much stamp of approval that man gives me and calls me righteous, God knows. See, it's about communion. It's about koinonia. It's about fellowship with Him and believing Him. From a personal relationship, not instituting your own actions, your own religious actions, in the name of God. And I say, again, the reason is because you have something that you don't want Him to confront you with. And so we think we're suspended
And really, we're not. We have settled down back on terra firma. We haven't went to the deep abyss, for we yet draw the breath of this life. But we certainly aren't drawing heaven to earth. We are settled back on terra firma. All because we resist and refuse, in the conscience, the Holy Spirit. That place that God would have us meet. But when our eyes single upon the things of the flesh, how great is that darkness? The prophet spoke, that man is you. Was a total surprise to him. Why? Because great is the darkness in him. Though he had the light, his eye became single upon the other world. And he grew dark. And when we settle back on terra firma, and when we are no longer standing in that position, in that state of faith, then there is where we grow dark, even unto our own selves. That's a dangerous place to be. Face God with your giant. Even if he can't get rid of him, face him. Don't run from God, run to him. You can't go on with God anyway until you get rid of that one. That's the giant that he's got you confronted with. You got to kill him. You can't go kill the Philistines when the Amorites are on your trail. You got to kill an Amorite. You hear me? And you might think that that's a tough one, but you ain't seen tough yet. But you ain't seen the fullness of God's ability to empower you yet either. Oh, gosh. I can see how Paul said in the Romans 11th chapter, he says, oh, how great are the riches of God's wisdom. Wow. Wow. Only God could do this. It's magnificent. It causes one to awe. Jaw-dropping awe of God. And it's reality. It's practical. It's today. It's this moment. The only moment you got is this one. The one that just passed is that direction. And the one is that direction. And the only one you got is this one. No guarantee of that one, and that one's over with. What I speak to you is about the now. Okay. Are you still wanting me to go on, or are you tired? Come on, you know you can leave anytime you want. But you probably get a hard look. Actions of, I don't know where I was, so I'm just going to start. Actions of believing in God are works and are dead. That's what I just talked about, right? Those works that were outside of communion with him, those are dead works, though they be of faith, believing in God. They are of a type of faith that is not as virtuous as the faith of communion, that of believing God, because you just heard directly from the Spirit of God. You know why we don't hear from the Spirit of God and we hear many voices? It's because we're afar off, because we're refusing him us. We're believing in him, but we're not giving us to him. And therefore, there are many voices far away. But when you get close, there's only one voice. And that's the one you'll hear. See, so these works that are done out of believing in God are dead works. Those are the works that Paul referred to. Religious works, tithing, and blah, 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 blah. True religious facts. I like that. True religious facts without power to validate truth. See, religious acts are dead works. They're true facts. You remember? One-armed bird. The true facts are one-armed. It's not in what is written, but it is what is in also written. Truth. Truth is a two-winged bird. True facts is a one-winged bird. Religious works, dead works, are true facts. But truth is done in believing God, in ears to hear. Not in hearing, but ears to hear.
What I saw this week was these religious works, when they're I mean, you have to die to self in order to be resurrected into the life of Christ. You have to do that. So when you're doing these works outside of his life, then even though they're, you're doing it within your own abilities, and there's plenty of people that have plenty of talent, I mean, we see this in the church, in the world, in the system, but without the life of Christ, then it's no longer a kingdom work.
Amen. Yes, that's what Paul referred to in the first few verses of chapter 13 of 1 Corinthians. They're dead works. But they're also performed by carnal Christians. Dead works are performed by unregenerated, but they are also performed by the regenerated. Dead works are. That's unsuspended. That's back on terra firma. That's not being in the place of no possibilities. That's not on the reliance on the atonement of Christ. See, it's capable. And that's really a worse place to be, because if you're doing works in unregenerated, you're crying out those testimony of those things of the Lord. He may not be with us, but he's for us. But being with them is, and not doing them, dead works, is like Judas. It's better to be outside the kingdom of God declaring God's kingdom than it is to be in the kingdom of God and falsely representing a relationship that you don't have. You see what I'm saying? You have better chance of repentance out here than you do in here. For great is the darkness that you have allowed to penetrate and filtrate into your heart when you're here. The actions of faith energized by love. That's another thing, isn't it? That's a kettle of another fish. The faith that's energized by love, reveal the works of the Spirit. Big S, little s. When I say Spirit, by the Spirit, I mean the conjunction, the joining together of the Holy Spirit in our spirit. That's what I mean by when I say the love energized, or the faith energized by love, reveal the works of the Spirit. Big S, little s. And establishes God to us and in us the evidence that he has revealed to us and that we are engaged in the spiritual war for the promise, and also example him to others, truth sprouting from the soil of Koinonia. But these actions alone do not justify us to God, as that was preeminent in that we believed God. In these actions that are not dead works, but they're actually energized by love, these faith actions, they in themselves establish us in the love of God. For it is the love of God that establishes us. It's a faith that apprehends. It's a hope that holds on. It's the love that establishes us. So these faith actions that are energized by love establish us. But that which that has justified us, that which has is being reflected unto the people, is that has stemmed or grown from, is that the evidence, the preeminence, the importance, is based upon the believing God, not the action. You've forgotten what the point was, haven't you? I'm making a point about the paradox. You remember the paradox of Abraham, where Paul said he wasn't justified by his works, and James was saying he was justified. He was justified because of his works. I'm still talking about that paradox, and you can take the notes, and you can go read it, and you can study it out. But that's what I'm still talking about. So I'm saying that dead works, obviously, dead works cannot justify you. But are you raising your hand or wiping your brow? Well, what is it?
This reminds me of that man, Howard Pittman.
Yeah.
The
guy that died on the operating table that was a preacher for 40 years or something.
Well, he was in ministry of some kind, helps and children's elderly and taught Sunday school and did all these things. And he had an aneurysm in his stomach and actually left his body on the table, and he went to heaven, and the Lord told him that he couldn't come in. And he said, why? He said, because you don't, you know, you haven't made me God of your life. And he said, well, I have, Lord. He went through all of his stuff. I've done this and done that, and I was involved in church, and I gave tithes, and I
prophesied, I raised the sick, I cast out the devil.
I don't have you. And he said, you have another God on the throne of your heart. He said, no, Lord. And he said, who, what? And he said, S-E-L-F. You have. And you've done all those works for yourself, not for me. The man was mortified, of course. He was allowed to live, came back to his body. And he's gone and preached that message from the day he came out of that operating room, that if it's things are done not by the love of God and motivated by that and only what he tells you to do, then you're doing it in your own work and your own efforts, and it's doubtful that it's even good, going to be counted to you.
Apart from me. Yeah. I don't want you to lose that thought, because all that is being said. But also I don't want you to lose thought of, I'm trying to show you the paradox here between the two scriptures. And then I'll finish. The Spirit establishes these faith-energized actions by the love of God, reveal the works of the Spirit, and establish God to us and in us. It's the love of God that establishes us in Him, and it establishes us to Him. The evidence that He has revealed us to us and that we are engaged in the spiritual war, the promise for the promise, and also these actions energized by love are example to others. God uses us, in other words. It's truth sprouting from the soil of our communion. But these actions alone do not justify us to God, as that was preeminent in that we believe God. That preceded the action. The yielding of the will up to death, that is that which justifies us before God. But it's the catalyst for the fruits. You know, the Galatians talks about that the works of the flesh are blah, 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 blah. And then it says, but the fruits of the Spirit are love, joy, these kind. But the difference is he didn't say the works of the Spirit, and contrasting with the works of the flesh. He said the fruits. And this that I speak of here, that we believe God, is the catalyst for the fruits. The fruits stem from the nature change. See the subtleness of that? It's not works that you're performing because you're trying to please God, so therefore you can be justified. But it's heeding at the will gate, the will of man, which allows the entrance of the Holy Spirit, which changes the character as you put off and put on, that is a catalyst for the fruits of the Spirit. In other words, as you grow in the Spirit, you become more like Him, and that you do is inherent with what you believed. You see? It's something different than doing works. It's something that you're yielding to that allows the fruits of God to affect your being, that then become a catalyst for your fruits, for the love, the joy, the peace, the long-suffering, the willingness to forgive a suffered wrong, taking no thought of a suffered wrong, being patient, being kind, never failing. That's the fruits. That's a result of the believing God. Not believing in God, for those are works. God knoweth, and God knows what I'm trying to say. I'm hoping you're grasping what I'm saying. Because what I'm saying is, from my heart, it's just, it seems a little muddied. Living works are a result of fruits of the Spirit. You shall know them by their fruits. You know them by their works? No, because your works won't tell you nothing. Works don't tell you nothing. They really don't. Fruits tell you something. And fruits is something that's a catalyst from something that's happened internally. That what happened inside of you that justified you before God wasn't the works. It was you yielding the will, which brought to bear the empowerment of the Spirit of God, which made the effective change in you as you put Christ on, as you stared into the mirror of Christ, as you are changed from glory to glory. That was the catalyst for that which you now do. Living works. Fruits. Out of the abundance of the heart, a man speaks. A bad tree can't bear fruit, but it can do good works. Okay? Not to be confused, because God knows the motive. Yes, Kate?
Don't you think so much of that is done because you're not in a true relationship, so therefore you don't feel the fulfillment, that void is inside of you? So you're trying to fill that void by doing this and doing this and doing this, all these works for the Lord. And none of it's going to fulfill the true love of being in a relationship and speaking with Him and having your eyes on Him and beholding Him. And by beholding Him brings the healing that brings all these fruits of God.
Yep.
And that void will never be filled by trying to do all these things to please Him. The only thing that pleases Him is, like you said, being broken and being in relationship with Him. And that love will fill all that void, and then all the rest.
There's a confusion between the void that is produced by the confrontation of the Almighty God with the will of man. There is that void, that mental assent that religion is putting upon you to do. I'm saying if you want to get the favor of God, you got to fill in the blank. That's a void that's created by religion that you try to fill in dead works. And you can fill that in dead works. That's a different void than the void that I speak of. The void I speak of is that place where you have realized that the only thing that can fill you is God and the things of God. Contrast that one with the other. Okay. That was the introduction.
Now for the real lesson.
Are you up to any of it, or you want to stop? Come on now. I don't care. That's the best for the moment. I'd hate for you to ask me about the three frogs that were in Revelations. Go ahead.
I was sitting here thinking about we cannot measure ourselves, but we are taught to measure ourselves, and that's a big problem with religion and with a lot of the systems we live in, say, even on the job, employee of the week, or all those kinds of things. And so when you were talking a few minutes ago, I thought about, you can't even examine yourself like the guy that Patty was talking about. The only way you are measured is beholding Him.
Yeah.
And so if you're not, going back to what you said last week, it was a time there, but beholding Him, which says you don't measure yourself by anything. You can, if you want to measure, it's like, are you beholding Him?
Yeah.
Yeah. The more you behold in Him, the more you're Carnelian.
Yeah.
And that light shining on your darkness, and then He's revealing it to you.
Yeah.
Then after that, it's just a matter of, you want to fake yourself out.
Yeah.
You know, do you want to say, oh, it's not God?
Yeah.
Know? And there you are.
Yeah. Anytime you find yourself measuring your performance, you're losing your suspension. And you've stopped looking at the mirror of Christ. And that's what we have a tendency to do. And we become
justified in our own eyes by that, those religious acts that we are doing. That's a dangerous place to go. And that's what Paul meant by forgetting those things were past. I don't have considered myself to have apprehended, but pressing forward. That is not allowing yourself to look at what it is that you've done, neither the negative nor the positive. But you today, this moment, this second, you've put your focus back on Jesus Christ. Quit gauging yourself. He said, I don't care. I don't care if you judge me. Only thing that matters is God judge me. I don't even judge myself. Let God be God. I'm just going to press forward. And that's really the prayer that I brought forward here that goes along with what you said in Philippians chapter 3, where Paul said, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Broad is the way. Broad is the way to destruction. Narrow is the way of life. This is a narrow way that God's choosing us. It's not a broad way. You're right. The generations and generations of human beings have went the broad way. But you know what? The voice of God was upon them all the way. His voice, just like His wrath, His voice of mercy, His persuading voice, encompasses the whole earth and every soul, for God said He would that not one would perish. But broad is the way that leads to destruction because we are hard-hearted. Now, I believe the reason that I have standing before you where I am is because He is the Father of the fatherless. Now, He chooses. God can choose to amp up. He fulfills His own word in that He's a father to the fathers. So for whatever reason that we were open to the word of God, we sit here. But the where we sit here is not a secure place. It's in that place of no place. It's suspended. If it's a place in you, if it's a concrete place, you need to kick it out. You need to destroy that you've established as good and right and holy and acceptable and moving forward with God. You need to get rid of all of that garbage and establish again your insufficiency, your inabilities, and look for the koinonia of God. The repentance, that He is calling you to, the deep calling into deeper. Okay, that's enough, isn't it? That's enough. Maybe I'll come back whenever and finish it, or maybe we'll start all anew and fresh. I certainly enjoy the rest of it, but, you know, there's a lot been said that I guess if we could digest and chew on what it is that's been said, it'd be sufficient unto today. Again, I'm so appreciative of your attention and your willingness to listen and to participate. Thank you. Your hunger draws it, makes it a lot simpler. If I was staring at a lot of hard faces that doubting and scowling and I don't know, I've been there. That's tough. That's tough. It's shaking, and yeah, that's the worst. I've been there. That one righteous one that's sitting out there just that knows everything. It's just, I tell you, when you get in those situations, you just have to look at your feet. You preach to your feet. You just look and just glance, but you try to not see anything. I'm so grateful that that's not the case. That I can make eye contact with anybody in here. And just feel the transparency of your heart. And I really appreciate that. It's a fertile soil, and it's a wonderful ground from which that I can speak. It's a great venue for me. So I bless you in the name of Jesus for whatever that means and whatever that's worth. A lot of ground covered there, but I'd like you kind of keep in mind that we were explaining the purposes of the law and how the law is good inside of us, and it's what it does, and why we should put as much of it in us as we can. For it's the mirror that we look into. And that's what negates us, which is the good thing. It's not a bad thing. So the encouragement, the exhortation is put more word in. Put more word in. You know, we got issues. We all got issues. But I promise you the issues can be handled with the word of God. We just got to learn how to deal with it once we learn what it is. How to deal with it. And it's there. None of us are faced with something that's not common to man. That he's not able to give us a way to overcome. He has it all in there. And know this, that your brethren are suffering also. But that's a good thing. I mean, suffering is not a bad thing. The road to peace and righteousness is not a smooth, gentle slope, but it's a rocky, thorny path. It's rocky, thorny. And we're made to walk barefoot. That's the way. And that's the way of peace and righteousness. Know that. That's the way. That's God's way. If things were all smooth, you'd get the misconception that you have arrived. Don't pray for none of these things that happen in your life, because if you do, that just simply means that, you know, you won't grow. But if you find yourself hardened, or you find yourself apathetic, or you find yourself discouraged or disappointed, turn your heart toward the Lord. That's a sign that you're losing something that you value more than Him. And you're trying to hold on to it for all you got. That disturbs your peace. This is tough, ain't it? Oh, God, I'm so glad He decided He'd help us. Heavenly Father, I ask You to bless this group again. I thank You for the time and the moments. And until we meet again, I ask that Your mercy keeps us. We appeal to Your mercy, to Your love. And we know that that Your faithfulness, joined with our faithfulness and our communion with You, changes the future. It changes the past, and it changes the present, and it changes the future. So, Lord, we ask that You mercifully speak unto our lives, that which was meant to be bad for us, that You turn the tables and you make that be that which promotes Your kingdom and promotes us in Your kingdom. In Yeshua's name we pray. Amen.